just like, you know, people might just employ the last little extra space more than even if I'm running around with two more. I think that's
air. I think we're
good. Okay. Yeah.
So as we're waiting for Alexandra to get here, hello Alexandra.
Hi.
I'd just like to welcome you all here for this panel discussion. I'm Justin Rabideau, the director of the Zuckerman Museum of Art at Kennesaw State University. Really, really happy to see all of you here, and really honored to have been asked by Makeba, who put this panel together, to be a part of it, and I'm really interested to hear what kind of conversations we'll be having today. So thank you all again for coming tonight. Quickly, I would like to just thank BURNAWAY, who was our partner organization in creating this event. When we reached out to BURNAWAY early on, before our AIDS America opened up, to kind of start the dialogue around having some sort of conversation around diversity and inclusion, based on some of the controversies that were brought up at the Tacoma Art Museum around the exhibition Art AIDS America. And we really thought that this exhibition, it was so rich and had so many possibilities to open dialogue that we really wanted to tap into that. So we held a roundtable discussion here at the Goat Farm, actually, in January, which I'll be talking about more, I'm sure. And after that discussion, we really felt that it was important to try to relive some of that energy and some of that dialogue in a public forum. So thank you to BURNAWAY for partnering with us to develop this discussion. Also, I'd like to thank WonderRoot, who jumped in on this project as well. They're offering some technical assistance and have helped promote the show. So thank you to WonderRoot and Floyd over there. Wave, Floyd, everybody. All right. And also, of course, the Goat Farm Art Center for offering their space, the technical support, the chairs, the seating, this beautiful place here, the Rodriguez Room. So thank you very much to the Goat Farm, especially Mercer West, Danny Davis, and Anthony Harper for their support of this program. And I'd also like to thank Makeba Dixon-Hill for agreeing to be our panelist, or being our moderator for the panels today. Makeba put together this group of panelists for our discussion, and thank you, Makeba, for doing that. You've been great all along. And I'll let you introduce the panelists when we start. And finally, just like to thank the staff of the Zuckerman Museum and our advisory board for supporting the programming that we do. So thank you all for coming tonight, and I'll hand it over to Makeba.
Thank you so much, Justin. There was a conversation that served as the point of entry into this conversation on arts, diversity in museums, but there was always this open-ended question that led us to wanting to talk to arts administrators about it. And it was this question about, what do you do when you get to the table? So when we're looking at these alarming rates of a lack of diverse voices inside of mainstream museums, there exists under 20% of people of color and underrepresented groups that make up museum workers. There also becomes this moment where we're shining the light on, well, what is our role? And what do we do when we get at this proverbial table? So that's gonna be this arc of how we're talking about those people who are sitting in the room and part of conversations that are making decisions on what are you looking at when you go into a museum, what are the types of conversations that are going to happen when you enter in the space, and ultimately, what are the decisions that are being made about who gets hired and where they ultimately go. So those are just some of the rooting places that we'll go. And I couldn't think of any other people than the ones that are up on the stage on the computer. What's up? It's great to see you. And so with that, each of these panelists represent, gosh, innovators, people that are also looking at policy issues, and as well as questioners and allies, okay? So those are just some of these words that come to mind when I'm just spoken. So I'm gonna do a brief introduction for each of the panelists, along with a little bit about their story and their connection. So I'll start with the person closest to me, and this is Anthony Knight. So I met Anthony when I was in a museum fellows program at the Atlanta History Center. And this is a museum, a program that is specifically connected to tying underrepresented groups into museums all over the country. And Anthony was running that program, and this was one of the oldest programs that I know of in this city, and so it was going in 1994. And so a little bit about Anthony. Anthony currently is the president and CEO of the Bataan Foundation, a Georgia nonprofit organization that serves the emotional, intellectual, and cultural needs of Black boys in grades 5-9. Before founding the foundation, Knight worked for 22 years as a museum educator and a consultant in Florida, Washington, D.C., and Georgia, to name a few. Knight's work with the Bataan Foundation reflects his ongoing interest in the issues and practices related to the collecting, preservation, and interpretation of information about the material culture of the African diaspora. Knight holds concentrations in Spanish, English, and museum education. Next to Anthony is Dr. Andrea Barnwell Brownlee. So I kind of look to her as almost a compass in terms of what's happening in the field. Yes, what's happening in the field, and also this model of what is possible as a worker from the inside of institutions. So Andrea is, let's just get right into her. Andrea Carlo Brownlee is an art historian, curator, writer, and the director of the Spelman College Museum of Fine Art. She has curated and co-curated many exhibitions of local, national, and international acclaim. Brownlee is the recipient of several academic, professional, and scholarly awards, including the 2013 David C. Driscoll Prize in African American Art and History. She is an alumna of Spelman College and earned her PhD in Art History from Duke University. In addition, Brownlee currently serves on the board of several arts organizations, including the Charles White Archives and WonderRoot, and is a trustee of the Association of Art Museum Directors, that's AAMD. She is currently spearheading the college's curatorial studies program, a pilot program funded by the Andrew W. Mellon Foundation that has a lot of the same characteristics of the Atlanta History Center. And so now to Justin Rabideau. So in many instances, he, along with the staff of the ZMA, are the reason why we're having this conversation right now. And we'll get into this in more detail as we start to kind of go into the questions. And with that in mind, this is a message to you all in the audience. We're gonna do something a little non-traditional, and that is if you feel moved to ask a question in the middle of this conversation, feel free to do that. Because definitely around his work, his artistic practice, I think that it can have these moments of pregnant pauses that get us really thinking about the future. So Justin is the director of the Bernard A. Zuckerman Museum of Art, located at Kennesaw State University in Kennesaw, Georgia. Originally from New York, Rabideau is a celebrated visual artist and employs many of the lessons learned as a working artist in his work as an arts administrator. In these fashions, he has received grants from the National Endowment of the Arts and the Georgia Council of the Arts, and has garnered local and national attention for his museum's exhibitions. And now, Alexandra Siclait. It was kind of an act of fate to be connected with her through our friends at the Office of Cultural Affairs. And when I was speaking to a colleague of mine about the panel, she immediately thought of Alex, and the reason was this global perspective on kind of opening up a conversation around diversity and inclusion in museums. So Alex is a cultural diplomacy enthusiast from Haiti who loves to explore how the power of art can foster a better understanding of cultures and empower communities. She has worked with the Community Folk Art Center in Syracuse, New York, a public relations firm in New Orleans, and the Smithsonian's National Museum of African American History and Culture in Washington, D.C. Prior to joining Creative Capital in her current post in the Professional Development Program Division, she served as the program manager for the City of Atlanta's Mayor Office of Cultural Affairs, awarding and administrating over $1 million in contracts for art services. Siclait received her BA in political communication from George Washington University and the same school that Anthony got his master's, and her MS in public relations and an MA in international relations. Before we even move forward, I want to thank the four of you all for agreeing to be on the panel and share your perspectives. You're very welcome.
Thank you.
You're very welcome. So I really want to get into a conversation asking you to kind of go down memory lane for a bit, okay? And that is, it reminds me of a work of art by an artist collective called Adebanga Jones and Associates. They're based in Houston, and many of their contemporary works are interventions. And one of their, I guess, a work that received a lot of attention was in the Whitney Biennial, where they had a police car turned upside down with a disco ball in it, and the sounds that were coming from the center of the space included a police dispatch conversation along with Public Enemies Fight the Power, and it would be on loop, and the title was We Did It for Love. And so while we have this conversation where we will be bringing up what's wrong with the system, but also what are the solutions, what are some conversation points about building it and understanding it, problematizing it, there also becomes this moment of why are we actually here? And that's because we love art, and we love, we have an affinity for the institutions that we decided to work in, or even this power structure that we're a part of. So what I would love for you all to do, starting with you, Anthony, is to really talk about what brought you into the field.
Well, before I begin, I'd like to thank all of the entities that seemingly moved heaven and earth to get all of us here. And I really appreciate you, Makeba, for moderating, taking a chance to moderate this kind of panel and to have this kind of discussion. I think any teacher knows the feeling that one has to see a former student become the professional that she has become. It's just an amazing thing to witness, and I'm so grateful to have had that experience. What brought me into the field, like a lot of folks that come into the museum field, was luck. I was living in Washington, D.C. I left my home in New York in 1990, because for me, New York is just an overwhelming city. I love it dearly, but it's overwhelming. And so I wanted a smaller environment. I had not long returned from living in South America. And so DC was close enough, it seemed manageable enough, and it was very similar to New York in many ways, culturally and in other ways. So I moved to DC. After maybe 6 months living in DC, a friend of mine, actually a family member had, who had gone to Howard and still had a lot of connections in Washington, suggested that I talk to this woman at the Smithsonian. So I went to the Anacostia Museum one day and spoke to Portia, and the next thing I knew, she was offering me a consulting job working in the Latino community, mostly because I spoke Spanish. It certainly wasn't because of my museum background, but because I spoke Spanish and they needed someone who could go into the Latino community in DC to do research in preparation for an exhibit, Black Mosaic, that would take place 5 years down the road. And so that sparked an interest in me, I guess, and one that I didn't know existed, to be honest, but I worked at the Anacostia for maybe almost a year. After that contract ended, I did some other contractual work for another bureau at the Smithsonian. That ended, there were no other jobs to be had at the Smithsonian, at least not contractually at that time. And so I fell back on what I was always, I guess, falling back on, and that was teaching. So I ended up in the Washington, D.C. public school system, teaching high school English and creative writing. But somewhere, maybe a year or so later, I learned about this program at the Smithsonian. They were trying to figure out how to get public school teachers more involved in the Smithsonian and to better make use of the Smithsonian's resources. So they had this whole program outlined. It was maybe during the summer, I don't really remember right now, but whatever it was, I asked my principal if I could be part of the program. She agreed. And so I was teaching during the day, going to the Smithsonian some days, and this kind of hodgepodge existence. And that really hooked me. And I really realized that I wanted to work in museums and not teach in a public school anymore. So I was talking to a friend of mine, actually he was a director, Stephen Newsom, who's unfortunately now deceased. And we were talking one day and I said, you know, it kind of looks like I like this museum stuff. What do you recommend? Oh, you need to go to GW, they have a great program. So I called GW thinking that I was George Washington University, thinking that I was talking to the lady who was the director of the Museum Studies Department. I was actually talking to the woman, Carol Stapp, who is still the director of the Museum Education Department. So Carol and I were talking, and I told her I wanted to work in museums, and gave her my background, and I said, you know, my goal is to be a museum director, and I need to be in, you know, museum studies, and thank you for your time. And so she said, no, don't hang up. She said, because the research shows that museum directors generally come out of the programmatic education side of museums. And I said, oh, really? I said, well, then I need to talk to you. So anyway, long story short, Carol and I met, I applied, got in, started in June of 1993, and that program, and particularly Carol Stapp, literally changed my life, and that's how I got into the field.
I never knew this about you.
I see that.
Would you like to go next?
Sure, I could do that. So while you were answering this question, really for me, what I was thinking about is what got me to graduate school. And essentially, growing up in Haiti and being a transnational, always traveling between Miami, Florida, and Haiti, I always had to navigate different cultural systems. And quickly, I realized at a young age, I had to essentially continuously brand the image that Haiti had in people's minds. And I found myself always entangled in conversations of trying to explain what Haiti was, what the experience was, how we lived. And when I eventually decided that I wanted to pursue something I was passionate about, for me, it was doing the public relations and international relations could mix. But I realized I wanted to do it with art and culture, because that's where I often found ways of connecting with individuals who had this misunderstanding about Haiti. So the long story short was that I found a very natural progression in talking about cultural diplomacy, because that's often how I found my way of connecting to individuals who really knew a basis that was very similar to what they did where they were from. We immediately found ways to find connections and meaningful relationships. So for me, that's how I ended up in this field. I knew that at some point I wanted to work in an arts institution. I had a very nebulous vision of what it is that I wanted to do. I just knew I wanted to work in the arts. And when I pursued my graduate degrees in public relations and international relations, I made sure that my internships were highly involved in the arts. And I tried to structure my internship so I learned a different aspect of cultural diplomacy. So when I was at Syracuse, I got involved in public programming. When I went to New Orleans, I got involved in public relations. When I went to the Smithsonian, I got involved in public affairs for the museum. And then what I realized at the end is I knew nothing about how funding happened. So Nikki Estes offered me an internship at South Arts, where I got to learn more about funding. And then that led into a position at OCA from that experience. So that's my short story.
Thanks, Alex. So Andrea, what about you? That single defining moment that then shifted to, this is why I'm doing it.
I'm not sure if there's, I guess, one single moment for me. I actually grew up in Alexandria, Virginia. Spent a lot of time at the Smithsonian. That's where we did all of our field trips. So I spent a lot of time in museums growing up. One defining moment, that's a little tough for me. I think that I had to, at one point, make the decision after I was in the graduate program in art history at Duke. You have to decide, do you want to be a museum professional or do you want to be an academic? And as someone who grew up in a household where I was telling some students earlier today that my dad was always quoting, you know, Yogi Berra, and when you come to the fork in the road, you choose the fork. And so I just simply felt like I never had to choose, to be perfectly honest with you. So for me, I would say that the single defining moment was when Spelman College, which happens to be my alma mater, decided to build a museum, and they invited me to come back and be its first full-time director. So at that moment, I realized I didn't have to choose. I could be on an academic campus, and I could also find a way to pursue and continue my ongoing love affair with objects. So if I had to choose one moment, it would probably be the time that I decided to return to Spelman in this particular capacity.
That's so interesting to hear how everybody found their way into the field. For me, it was I found my way in the way a lot of people find their ways into the museum field is kind of by happenstance and chance. And I come from a studio art practice, from a studio art background. My drive and my interest when I was in school was really based on developing myself as an artist, as a practicing studio artist. But while I was in school, I had some really incredible mentors that really guided me along the way and said, listen, it's great that you want to be a studio artist, but really what you need to do while you're here is utilize every single opportunity that you have at your hand, at the university to really broaden your base and to find ways that you can utilize your skills in other methods and other ways. So I started off doing internships at my university museum, and that's where I really started finding the passion for the field and really discovering that it was something that that I could apply the creative side of apply the kind of the artistic side of myself while also doing something that I felt was really meaningful work and something that I felt like I was engaging with the community, engaging with the public. So that's really getting that start through internships at my local university kind of started that excitement for the field. But funny enough, one of the big pushes for me to actually move in the direction of committing to the museum field was after I left graduate school and I moved up to Syracuse, New York. And I was like, all right, I've got an MFA, now what? And, you know, I think a lot of people that are in the studio practice, they have that realization is that they leave that warm comfort of the university and discover, how do I market myself? What do I do? And I was like, well, you know, I need to get a job. So if I'm going to get a job, it's going to be in the arts. And, you know, whatever I do, I'm going to do something in the arts. And my first job out of MFA is that I went and I was like, all right, if I'm going to get a job anywhere, let me try to get a job in a museum. And I got a job working as a security guard. And that was it. You know, it was like, I don't care what I'm doing, but as long as I'm around art, then at least I can feel like I'm doing something that matters. And it was an incredible learning experience for me. And, you know, I did it for about a year. And that's really how I ended up getting hired on as a curatorial assistant at the Everson, where I was the security guard. And it really made me realize that I had enough conviction to kind of to try, and no matter what I was going to do, I was going to be working within the arts. So security work led me into the profession in kind of an interesting way.
Thank you for sharing. And inextricably linked to the love affair comes the heartbreak. And I want to start with you, Andrea. When we kind of have this conversation on diversity and inclusion, there has to be some moment of exclusion that happens. So throughout your career, there has been that pivotal moment when you were a Mellon fellow. Was it a Mellon curatorial fellow? A MacArthur fellow at the Art Institute of Chicago. And it being this moment, I believe at that time it was the second largest museum in the nation, right below the Metropolitan Museum of Art. Can you talk to us a little bit about how it felt coming into that space and how the introduction of diversity and inclusion manifested itself for you there?
So the MacArthur Foundation at that point was really offering these exceptional opportunities for people that were in graduate programs to really cut their teeth on the museum world, and the museum professions. So when I got there, I think I was the second or the third MacArthur Curatorial Fellow. And so while my colleagues were wonderful and they were very helpful, I often felt this very real interest and desire for them to encourage me to only do the things that were about African American art or the projects that were only going to focus on community and engagement. And so there was a very real realization for me that this was going to be a different type of energy, not only from graduate school, obviously, but from what I anticipated. So that was the time when I learned that at that moment, most African Americans in museums were indeed in museum education, and that I was going to be traversing a different type of terrain. So that realization sort of made me want it even more, if you will, because I said, wait a minute, we have things to offer absolutely every department within museums. And so I went about the task of trying to figure out who were my allies, who were my co-conspirators, who was having similar feelings, who was trying to do what I was doing, which was write my dissertation from Chicago, I mean, in Chicago, where I was a candidate at Duke. So I was trying to do, you know, perhaps crazy and mammoth things at the same time, but I felt that it was important and something that I really wanted to do. So there was this sort of unspoken rule about, you know, where African Americans belonged within larger mainstream museums that became very palatable for me. So I went about the business of defining that idea and thinking more deliberately about curatorial efforts and a curatorial career.
And when we talk about curatorial methods, I think we start to open up the space to curatorial practice. And Justin, in many instances, we're having this conversation because of Arts AIDS in America at the ZMA. And to just kind of fill everyone in, there was, Justin alluded to the conversation around getting people together to be in discussion around an exhibition that was initially created that was severely underrepresented with voices that are inextricably linked to the conversation around AIDS and HIV, which is a global issue, and omitted so many voices of color from the space. And with that particular vision and allyship, and just automatically just connecting back to the reason why you decided to get into the museum, any means necessary, convened a discussion to work through what does this mean for this institution, and having people in the room to offer suggestions. Can you dive a little bit into what happened and also communicate institutionally the why? Like, why did you even want to invite people to the table to have this conversation, and what were some of those objectives for you and your staff?
Yeah, sure. So to give a quick background as much as I can about our AIDS America, the exhibition was, is this still working?
Yeah.
Okay, sorry. The exhibition was developed and curated by Rod Pushka from the Tacoma Art Museum and Jonathan Katz from SUNY Buffalo. And this exhibition has been about 10 years in the making. And it really, for those of you that have not had an opportunity to see it, it will be open until Sunday this week. The exhibition really delves into how this disease, HIV and AIDS, has really impacted art making practices and the communities that surround it, and then our greater kind of community and scope with an American focus. We at the Zuckerman really felt really strongly about bringing this exhibition to our community. And you know, given the fact that Atlanta has been affected so greatly by HIV and AIDS, we felt that it was important to have that conversation and open up the dialogue around the show. But unfortunately, the curators, they missed some marks with this exhibition. 10 years in the making, but yet out of the 92 artists that were represented in the exhibition, only four of them were African American artists, and only one of those artists was a female. So there were some issues with the checklist of that exhibition. So thankfully, while the show was up in Tacoma, There were some activists associated with Black Lives Matter movement and the Tacoma Action Collective that raised issue with that, with those statistics in the exhibition. And that opened up a window for the Zuckerman, who was a venue for the exhibition, but not the curators. And typically, you know, as a venue for a traveling show, there are not a lot of opportunities to do, especially for a small museum like the Zuckerman, not a lot of opportunities to do additional work within the show. So we had recognized some of these issues, and we're thinking about doing public programming and things like that. But the activism that occurred at Tacoma gave us this window with the exhibition, and frankly, the desire to really address it in a way that felt meaningful and sensitive and impactful for our own community. So we brought together a group of individuals whom we respected, who we've worked with in our community, to talk about these issues, to bring them out onto the table, and to really see what we could do as an institution to create a response, to create some sort of meaningful engagement around this so that we would be addressing it in a mindful way, in a way that was sensitive, that was respectful, that was connected to our community, and really thinking about how we can leverage our community, the strength of our community, to overcome some of the weaknesses of our institution, right? And I think that's one thing that the Zuckerman really focuses on, that we've been doing in our short 2 years time that we've been here, is thinking about how we can leverage our community and work with our community to really address some of these issues and to utilize our community's strength where we may be failing. So it was a really incredible conversation. That through that conversation, we developed several action steps around the show to address those issues. But it also was so energizing for myself and my staff it made us realize that we wanted to continue this dialogue, that so often exhibitions, they have a start and a finish, and there's great things that happen in between. But how do we continue these kind of conversations so that they live past the show? How do we continue them so that they exist in a way that we can tap into that energy after the exhibition comes down? So part of this idea was bringing this panel together and trying to dig into some of these ideas in a public forum.
What I found interesting was it moved beyond conversation to an opportunity where you can see the touch in the space. So being able to walk through the gallery space and see the insertion of artists of color that represent Latino communities, Pacific Islander communities, African American communities that weren't there before. And so it was interesting to engage diversity as a curatorial practice, because essentially you changed the show. And so I'm really interested in hearing either from you and or Andrea, because what I always find interesting at the Spelman College Museum of Fine Art is a traveling show ends up being a Spelman College Museum of Fine Arts show. And so, but this was something that I really wasn't aware of. And I think that when we're kind of thinking about change in general, in mass, it doesn't just happen when someone just offers you the carrot or the deal or the opportunity. There's always room for accepting it with additions to it. So can you talk a little bit about how you would be framing this inclusionary practice in the way that you move forward with your curatorial work? Who does it matter?
I guess the short answer to that is that it has so greatly impacted how we think about the shows that we produce. Our AIDS America was an incredible learning tool. Not only for our community, but really for the staff of the museum in framing how we shape our exhibitions and think about the ideas of inclusion in our shows. And realizing and really kind of taking it as a personal and institutional mission to not have that as it's not an option. It's a requirement, I think, for an institution to include our community in those in our exhibitions, to make them relevant, to make them something that they feel a part of. And going forward, our curators and our staff will be focusing on some of the items that we've learned from our AIDS America and looking at how we frame our exhibitions. Now typically, for us, we don't bring in a lot of traveling shows. Most of our exhibitions are curated in-house or through guest curators. But regardless of that, there will be an eye towards the methods that we use in Art AIDS for future programs. I'd be interested in hearing what Andrea has to say about that as well.
So three interrelated things come to mind for me. And I honestly didn't remember this until maybe 2 or 3 months ago. But I remember the Tacoma Museum calling me and inviting us to be one of the venues for our AIDS America. And I remember declining because there wasn't the voice. There was only one African-American woman. And we focus on art by and about women of the African diaspora. And I remember in hindsight being really, really appalled by that. Just really frustrated by the fact that I even got the call, to be honest with you. So that was one thing. The second thing that comes to mind is last summer when we went to lunch. And I honestly did not remember that initial invitation to present the show. But I was so excited when you said you were bringing this show. And the first thing that I said to you was, oh, is Rotimi Ifani Coyote in the show? And your face dropped. It was just, I was like, uh-oh. You know, so it let me know. I asked about a few other artists, but it let me know that this was going to be a real opportunity for conversation and for dialogue. And the third thing that happened around this show was talking to a colleague who was actually on that panel in Tacoma that made everybody just erupt with anger and frustration for obvious reasons, and him not getting it, and the fact that it had been 10 years in the making, and there was no advisory council, there were no outside conversations that were happening, and that it was okay, you know, that this show going off was okay. So those things sort of frame my recollection of how this project was initially created and perceived as well as received. In terms of my curatorial practice, you know, the Museum at Spelman is unapologetically, you know, focusing on works by and about women of the African diaspora. There's just no apology needed for that. And so when we bring, Makeba was referring to what happens when we decide to bring a touring exhibition. Sometimes there are small tweaks, and sometimes there are really, really big tweaks, because before we agree to present an exhibition, we think about a lot of things. How is it going to inform and allow our immediate communities, meaning the Spelman College students, faculty, and staff, to engage? How is it going to bring something different, something really special to Atlanta that no one else is bringing because of its unique focus on women? And in addition to that, do we mix it up? In other words, every show isn't a solo exhibition, every show isn't a group exhibition, et cetera, et cetera. So we're looking at how we mix it up. So one of the biggest things for me is, how do we engage the communities that come and view the show, and view the shows? Because we do take a lot of pride in this idea of getting people to commit to this experience. We want people to come and have an experience like they're not going to have at any other institution. So one of the most exciting things that has happened as of late was starting this yoga in the museum program and getting people to engage with works of art on a Monday when the museum is closed. And again, hats off to Makeba for really spearheading that effort. But it's a totally different type of engagement with works of art. So when I think about what does it mean to tweak didactic material or to bring in additional objects, those things become very real and deliberate curatorial decisions that, again, we sort of make unapologetically. So it also informs the original shows that we create. We think about our principal stakeholders first, and again, what are we going to present that's different than anything else that they've seen, that the audiences have seen in Atlanta, or could see in Atlanta, frankly. So audience reception really does inform my curatorial practice in ways that I frankly didn't realize until I was in the thick of it, maybe asking the third organizer of an exhibition, oh, could we just tweak this, or could we just do that? And it just became a natural thing for me just to not accept a packaged exhibition, not to accept a packaged show based on face value or based on what another venue did, or perhaps based even what the original curator perceived and conceived. I know it's a delicate issue sometimes because it's someone's intellectual property. It's, you know, that's what shows are. And so before we even say yes and sign on the dotted line, those sort of things have to be negotiated up front.
And I would that you could have the yoga class after hours is a great way to remove barrier to entry, because oftentimes museums are operating during the hours. The constituents that you want to attend are at work and can't even attend this exhibit. So this is a great way, I would say, of adding a level of inclusion to the sound.
So in this moment about why we're even here, you know, why are we having this conversation? We talked about their diversity and inclusion programs in museums that have been in existence as long ago as the late 1980s. The Getty Museum has a very prestigious multicultural summer program that has graduated people like Zoe Watley, who's now at the Victoria and Albert Museum in London. You have programs like the High Museum and their program that they have. So the question is, why are we still talking about this? Why? And Anthony, I want to ask you this because it also connects me to this amazing piece that was done by Bill T. Jones, a famous choreographer. And when his partner, Arnie Zane, passed away.
I can't hear Makeba.
Excuse me?
I can't hear you.
Okay, how about now? Yeah?
Okay. Try it again.
Well, if you hear us, Alex, just feel free to kind of come in when you can connect. But this particular dance piece was done by Bill T. Jones, and it was called Last Night on Earth. And it's in response to seeing his community become ravaged by the HIV virus, thinking about losing a partner in the dance community, and what he would do in his iconic style would include projections, video, dance, and spoken word. And what he would do was stand on the corner of the stage and engage the audience by yelling out these provocative questions. And there are two of them that just really resonated for me around this question. He said, "What time is it? Can you look in the mirror at this moment and be all right with it?" And just kind of locating this conversation of exclusionary practice in a genre and an art form that is all about uniting people together is exactly the reason why people made a decision not to end their lives, to love a particular person, to take a leap and accomplish a dream. You know, in many instances, we look to art as that healing salve, as that mediator, as that muse. And so knowing that these questions are still here, I'm curious to know from you, are having this conversation in 2016?
Well, that question for me, at least now, it wasn't always, but that question...
Would you be open to saying what it used to be? And then also what it is now since it did change?
Okay, let my thought finish. Because the question, the answer that I have now is different from what it might have been 5 years ago or 10 years ago. The answer now is another answer, another question rather, which they tell you you shouldn't do, but in this case you just have to. It's the question, the questions that are with this country forever. You know, we can't talk about museums outside of the context of the United States, outside of the context of world history. And maybe I'm a little different from others on the panel this evening because my focus has not been art. I love art, enjoy it, buy it, but that's not my focus. My focus is history. And so when I think of a question like that, why are museums still asking this question? And in my case, 25 years later, almost, or I guess 25 years later, I have to also then ask the question, well, why are black boys and men being killed every day like they were during slavery? Why are other groups in this country being treated and around the world? Why are black and brown bodies, people, minds, lives, cultures being treated, in my mind, the same exact way now as they've been treated for eons? And so this museum question for me is almost not even important anymore. It really isn't. Because, you know, maybe not like some of the other folks here, I wasn't really interested in any kind of an award. I wasn't interested in any special position working in a museum. I had no desire to be some fancy, you know, head bobbing, whatever, in a museum. My only concern when I first started and when I walked out the last museum I walked out of, my only concern was, do I get to work with black folks and work on black stuff? Only questions I've ever asked myself, because that's all that ever interested me. I didn't care anything else, literally, about anything else in any museum in which I've ever worked. If it didn't have something to do with black folks or black history and culture, yeah, it might be interesting, yeah, it might be fun, but I wasn't interested. And so perhaps I'm a little bit of, you know, an anomaly in the museum field, where so many folks and so many people I've met over the years just seem to have this desire to want to do all these fun, cutesy things in the museum. I've not been interested in that ever, never. And so, why are we still asking this question? apart from the answer I gave earlier, is because museums, at least in my opinion, museums don't want to include other people. It's pretty simple. And it really reminds me of, as I get older, and this coming Sunday, I will be 55, and as I get older, I really see things very differently. And I'm not as willing to put on those rose-colored glasses as maybe I might have been in my earlier years. Because to be truthful, when I hear statements like, oh, you know, we'd love to have more people of color working in our museums, or you know, we just can't find them. Well, I'm thinking to myself, it doesn't take a special kind of black person to head a finance department. It doesn't take a special kind of black person to head an education department. You don't have to have museum experience, necessarily, to run a damn museum.
Agreed.
And so, you know, when I hear this, it's almost ridiculous when I hear it. Because, particularly in a place like Atlanta, where you have all these amazing black folks and other folks of color who are doing all kinds of amazing things, for a person to tell me, oh, just can't find that, you know, qualified music. What, are you kidding me? You don't want to. I've done programming most of my museum career. And guess what? When I want to find someone to talk about a specific thing, 9 times out of 10, I find that person. So it's hard for me to hear people say they can't find someone. So what it looks like to me, without my rose-colored glasses anymore, is you don't want to. And I used to sit on all the diversity committees. I mean, I got my, you know, museum skills and started my career in Washington, D.C., the hotbed of museum life, maybe. Maybe next to New York, I don't know. But I was heavily involved, and mostly because of Carol and her leadership at that program, the museum ed program. You know, I was involved with AM. Oh my God, I did internship, I did this. They were calling me and sit on this panel and go here, and can you have IMLS, what used to be the IMS. Can you hear all of these institutions having all of these, what seemed to me at the time, meaningful conversations, what now seem to me to be meaningless conversations, all of these conversations about diversity, and here I am 25 years later, and it's the same stuff. And quite frankly, I'm tired of the conversations. I only did this, Makeba, because you asked me. I'm tired of the conversations. I'm tired of the what seems to me to be lies at this point in my life. Because if people want to change things, people change things. People don't keep talking about change, people change. You can't sit here and say, I need to get a new job. Oh my God, I need to get a new job. 5 days a week, 5 months, a year, I need to, damn it, go get a new job. And so, I'm sorry. Okay, I'm sorry.
Because we have a question.
I don't know why people create things. Obviously, they're probably, I have, you know, some personal thoughts that I don't know if I really want to share. But I think people, a lot of times, not always, But I think a lot of times people, institutions, and the people who lead them do things for political reasons. They do things because they are, you know, politically correct or culturally, they feel they might be culturally appropriate. But I have yet to feel, and I still have a lot of living in front of me, I guess, but I have yet to feel something that was done because there was a genuine interest in the people that the museum was serving. I have yet to feel that.
So I love if you answered that, Andrea, since there is a curatorial studies program that you're working on right now.
So I'll be the first to say that perhaps my glasses are still rose colored. I really, truly believe. Can you all hear me okay? I feel like this just went okay. I believe that there are several things that have happened as of late that give me even more reason to feel encouraged. I remember it must have been about 7 years ago. I was sitting at an AAMD meeting and we got called out as a field from the guest speaker from the podium, and he basically said, look at yourselves. Look at yourselves. You should be shamed, and you are sitting here in these ivory towers, and literally there were at that time only 3 black women in the audience. Me, Jeanetta Cole, and Thelma Golden. We were the only people in the room. And there are certainly others, but they weren't included in this conversation on a regular basis. The next meeting that we had, so it was probably two meetings later, so we meet twice a year. So that following year, we had some really, really sad, devastating news in the field. Jim Wood, who had been the director of the Art Institute of Chicago, who went on to the Getty Museum, had passed away. Peter Marzio, the director of the MFA Houston, had passed away. And again, there's this look at yourself moment. There was no pipeline that was created that would give African-American men or women the opportunity to really be included in this sort of pipeline. So once again, there was this sort of look at yourselves moment. So as much as I love seeing my colleagues that I just named, there was something that's like, I'm tired of seeing y'all and only y'all. So there was time to really think about being more deliberate. And so sometimes for me, being deliberate means going away and being quiet for a time. And so when I talk about these rose-colored glasses, I'm really, really proud of the fact that the Mellon Foundation, which has an incredible history with Spelman College, sort of heard my cry and invited me to submit an application to launch a curatorial studies program. So again, are you gonna just keep talking about it? Are you going to be proactive and try to make a difference? We'll know, you know, in over time whether or not these types of initiatives are fruitful. But for me, I believe that the time is really now to draw a line in the sand. And we started this program whereby we have 10 students. We wanted to deliberately start it slow in the pilot phase. And this program has 3 components: coursework, summer internships, and mentorships. And oftentimes the mentorships come by way of museum professionals, specifically curators, that come and meet with our students several times a semester. Moray Bouchon-Bird is our visiting professor, and it's about, for me, really giving people new opportunities, taking away this discussion about there not being any qualified candidates, which we all know is a ridiculous assertion. We all know it's a ridiculous assertion. So it also, for me, comes with the realization that of these 10 students, if 3 of them go on in the field, what an incredible percentage we have informed and been able to improve. I also believe that we do need people that are going to be in finance, that are going to be in development, that are going to be in special events, you name it. We need people of various perspectives in different departments within the museum. So, and if nothing else, we will spark a lifelong interest and a love of being in museums. Some of our best students are biology students who have decided that this is what they want to be. I was telling the students earlier today about these closeted art majors that come and knock on my door and tell me how excited they are about, you know, about museums and about art, but their parents won't allow them to focus on, you know, on art history or studio practice. So, for me, taking the bull by the horns and figuring out how are we going to methodically and systematically take the long lead and over time make an impact that is measurable is something that I'm really passionate about. And one of the things, and then I'll pass the mic, one of the things that I'm so excited about, so each of the students get a summer internship. As news has sort of come about these internships and about these students, my phone is ringing off the hook. Can we work with one of your students this summer? I was like, I only have 10, and they've all been deployed, if you will, and this is gonna grow, it's going to change, and it's going to continue. There are only a few museums in this country, the Studio Museum in Harlem being one of them, that have really established internship programs that focus on students of color. They've got elaborate panels and a review process and 3 deadlines or maybe 4 deadlines a year. So they're really ahead of the curve. So when I reflect back on this invitation from the Mellon Foundation to apply for support for this program, I think about the fact that not many people outside of professional associations were talking about this publicly. So a year and a half later, when they published their statistics saying that 4% of museum professionals are African American. 4. So to know that we've got this program that
is more African American, then we know that number is even less for other ethnic minorities.
That's right. Only 2% for Hispanic. And so it's very real. So to know that we had a program that was germinating and being formed, and then these statistics come out, it was something that we kind of knew, but here's the empirical evidence, if you will. Here is the statistic that goes along with that. So I give you sort of that long preamble to say that I'm really optimistic. I'm optimistic because I know that the women at Spelman College, and there's actually one more house student that's actually in the program as well, are being prepared to take on this art world. We've conquered many things as it relates to gender. We've still got a ways to go. All these studies that have been done on the gender gap, for example, we know we have a ways to go, but I share that long story with you all because my glasses are really an amazing shade of rose right now.
So in addition to a conversation on bringing people into the field, there's a real one around retaining them. And that is one of the reasons why I asked Alex to participate, because of her independent research and being tied to an organization like Creative Capital and their amazing funding strategies on how they are working in so many different ways to provide financial support to artists. So for the artists in the room, those that are listening to us right now through the live stream, look up Creative Capital, because there definitely are a lot of opportunities there, not only through the organization, but in their resource list that they provide on their website. Alex, there's this 5-step professional program model for artists. You shared with me your ideas about what that 5-point step would look like for arts administrators, because we're also learning that many of us who enter the field leave for the same reasons that are tied to being pigeonholed, being disenchanted with the work environment. It's a host of reasons, but could you speak a little bit about some of the things that have been coming up in your own independent research?
Yes, so a lot of what you're saying, Andrea, resonated with me, in part the mentorship, but something that I thought about, me, I did not get an art history major, I did not get an arts administration major, curatorial studies major, but I am passionate about history. I'm passionate about the arts, but if I, with my skill set, were to apply to a curatorial assistant position, my resume would be overlooked. Perhaps somebody would take a glance if they saw that the Smithsonian was on my resume, but for the most part, it's been a steep uphill climb. And I recognize that I didn't pursue arts administration or curatorial studies intentionally, but at the same time, I think there's this ideological purity that we have in the industry, that if you're not an art history major, curatorial studies major, that perhaps you can't do the work in the same way. And something that creative capital does really well in the way they support their artists is that they allow the artists to come from very diverse backgrounds. And something that I thought about when Makeba asked me the question about what do you think would retain arts administrators in the field, one of them is board leadership. I think that we are building great knowledge networks through the Mellon Foundation, but I would love to see if these foundations would also support doing board leadership, mentorship programs for young women and men and gender non-conforming individuals, because at the end of the day, a lot of the decision-making is happening in the boardrooms. And so it's fascinating to see that we want to talk about inclusion, then you look at a board of an organization and there's one person of color. I'm not really sure how the others on the board who do not understand the views of others who are not of color would even consider expanding or being more imaginative about what they expect to see. And to me, a lot of how the audience that you build in museums and cultural institutions change is based on who's on that board, who's gonna talk to their friend, who's gonna give money to another friend and get individuals involved. And I think that there's this notion that to be on a board, you have to have money, you have to be rich. But a lot of organizations are considering advisory networks where you're getting young individuals to voice their opinion in more of an advisory capacity than necessarily a financial capacity. And that's something that I learned a lot when I was in Atlanta and I participated in the United Way VIP program. But on the flip side, what was so disappointing was there was no art organization that was part of the roster of organizations that were looking for board members. So I think there was just one, and right now I can't remember the name of the organization, and I couldn't serve on that board because I've worked for the city. But that to me is what I would say is supporting the individual in the same way that creative capital has that step of supporting the individual. There are others, but I don't want to take over the floor. I don't know if I still have time to talk about the other points.
And you know, we're really approaching our the close, and it wanted to open up the floor for questions. But I'm reminded of Robin Kelly's Freedom Dreams, and this being a book that was comparing Martin Luther King's I Have a Dream speech to radical imagination, the Black radical imagination, but I think we can just really open this up. And for the role that you have, Justin, you know, being the leader of the institution, of course there's administrative work that's so tied to the work, and being a creative and a creator, I'm curious that if you have the opportunity to just dream and envision, you know, especially envision what the reality of your own reality of taking in all of the things that have happened in relationship to putting together our AIDS in America, the conversations that have happened before, because these are, you know, you all are known as an institution that takes risks. and it's also an institution that is tied to transformative communities that create communities that live beyond the institution, but there are also these moments of connecting the people that are at the table. So in with that power that you all have with facilitation, with just really touching on people to invite into the room, and then also with your own staff, let's just dream for a minute and tell us what would that look like for you at your specific institution.
So what would it look like going forward, or how do you?
There's going to be no boundary.
Right. Yeah.
Whatever feels right.
Sure.
And I know it's, you know, an extemporaneous question.
Right.
You know, but in terms of having the permission to dream.
Right.
You know, and envision the ecosystem differently, and being in such and being in this particular position of power, what would it look like to you? You know, how could that be manifested? And anyone else who I want to just give an opportunity for people to ask questions and respect everyone's time, but I just immediately thought about engaging you.
Yeah. That's a really interesting question. And I think this may sound like a simple answer or an answer that, a non-answer, but really what the dream would be for the Zuckerman, what the dream would be for our community and how the Zuckerman interacts with our community is really this notion of the institution acting as a facilitator to make room for our community. You know, to be able to utilize the assets of our community and to really break down the walls and the barriers that separate an art museum from the rest of the people that are around in our environment. In bringing in, opening up our doors, and figuring out a way to make that room, to have these dialogues, to be able to give agency and give voice to the people that are part of our community, and make the room in a genuine way to have the opportunity to have exhibitions, to have the opportunity to have programming that really feels impactful and meaningful in a way that is genuine, to make that room, to make those genuine connections. We are such a young institution. We're 2 years old. I was telling you, Makeba, when we were talking about this panel, I felt very humbled to be a part of this panel with the amount of talent that is on this panel, and to be able to talk, to be even just to hear what everybody had to say about it. And having these dialogues is a small way for us to be able to move the Zuckerman forward in a way to make more room for opportunity in our institution, and to be able to partner with other organizations and to break down that barrier, and break down those walls. So if I were imagining what do we do going forward, it's making more room for us to go forward together and to actually do impactful programs and exhibitions that are genuine and relevant.
Thank you. I would like to open it up to anyone who has a question.
Art Aids America came to be.
That's a great question. The answer is it wasn't okay. And it's something that that we, as the institution, really wanted to address. So we did not originate the exhibition, but we did feel that it was imperative that we try in some small manner to address that issue. And that was really where the conversation with our community members and the roundtable discussion that we had, we knew that that we needed to include our community not only in the exhibition itself, but in the conversation about how we address those issues in the show. So adding in a specific AIDS activism and around people that have worked within the Black and African-American communities around this disease to include those voices was imperative to make this exhibition relevant. The statistics right now are horrifying for HIV and AIDS, the new cases that are happening in Atlanta, and they're predominantly impacting the African-American community. So we needed to do something, and I'll be the first one to admit that what we did was no solution. I will never say that we solved the problem. What we did was, what we tried to do is, as I said before, we tried to make more room in the exhibition and to do it in a way that that at least felt respectful to our community. And I think in some manner we were able to succeed in that. And in others, I think we failed for sure. But going forward, I want to be an institution that's proactive. I think a lot of other institutions that would have faced that similar situation probably would have thrown up their hands. Like, well, you know, we don't have enough time to do something. We don't have enough time to do this.
But why?
Exactly. Yeah, because it's easy, maybe. Yeah. But, you know, no. We decided that, you know,
activate
we would not do
parents.
That. Sorry?
That's active. Right.
Yeah.
I don't know.
It is remarkable to take 10 years to develop an exhibit and then say I don't have time to include diversity, or I don't have time to listen to your reaction, when really I had so much time to consider your opinion while putting it together.
And I understand that this did not originate at Zuckerman. It came from, what was it?
Correct, yeah. So it was curated by Rob Kushka from the Tacoma Art Museum and Jonathan Katz.
Well, I wondered, and I was asking about the background, was there any, because I'm not familiar with what all happened around the exhibit, but were there any partnerships with like A Atlanta or any of those kind of organizations that are here that could have been a direct correlation with the subject matter?
Yeah, absolutely. So we partnered with Aid Atlanta, Someone Cares, Inc., and Sister Love were some of our key partners in this exhibition. An exhibition like this does not happen without partnerships. And the Zuckerman really relies heavily on collaborations and partnerships. We're such a small staff, such a small organization, and frankly, oftentimes we're swimming upstream, given our situation in a fairly conservative part of our metro Atlanta area. You know, we need strong partnerships in order to do some of the programming that we do. And absolutely, those individuals were key to us being able to address some of the issues around the show.
Thank you.
Justin, are you? I'm not sure to ask this, but are you saying that in the development that there wasn't sufficient funding from partners that had an interest in expressing a diverse voice?
From the curation of the show, is that
yes.
What you're saying?
Yes, I mean, we're...
Well, unfortunately, I cannot directly speak to the curation of the show. It was not something that we curated.
Right.
So really what we were presented with was 3 years prior to the show coming here, Rock was in town and meeting with various organizations and talking about the exhibition. But we did not receive a formal checklist for the show until a few months prior to the actual show being scheduled to come to Atlanta. So that time frame was very much condensed. But yeah, I cannot directly talk about the curation in that way.
Okay. So you can't draw funding issues
into it early on? No, there's no funding issues there. No, I mean, there was actually an advisory group that was formed, I cannot speak to that.
But again, you mentioned who's invited to the table, and I don't know who was on that advisory group, but
yeah.
Again, to your point, 10 years in the making,
yeah.
I'm not sure what type of advice they were doling out on a regular basis. However, the lapses are screaming. And, as I, again, reflect on that conversation that I had, it was, Sister Love is involved in the, this is from Tacoma, is involved in the project. But again, this inability to bring people with different perspectives, different backgrounds, different voices to the table is something that museums have to reconcile and reckon with on a regular basis. We were talking earlier this week about, a friend and colleague, Arnold Lehman, who used to be the director at the Brooklyn Museum, who said the most important book that we can read is the census. There's just absolutely no way that museums can even think about being relevant until we think about the communities that we serve, if we truly are interested in being a destination. And just one other quick thing, I know there are additional questions, but I wanted Alex to respond to something that you said about boards, and I couldn't agree more. And we're trying to figure out, as an industry and as a profession, how do we eat this elephant? Who is going to take on boards? And that's going to be AAM. We're trying to figure out who is going to take on curatorial and directorial issues, and that's AAMD. So literally, we are at the table trying to figure out how are we going to tackle this mammoth issue of museums being in dire straits, if you will, of just becoming irrelevant to the communities that we say we want to serve. So these are sort of some of the various parts of the puzzle that are just now starting to percolate.
And to add something to what you were saying,
Alex, we have one person in the audience that has been trying to say something. After she finishes, we'll go back to you, okay? Thank you. Sorry, Stephanie?
What I'm hearing is a lot of about a reactionary response versus intention. And I think that the Zuckerman was responsive to what happened in Tacoma. And I wanted to know in a smaller, measurable way, what you think impact of your response to the lack of representation of artists in this particular exhibit has done for future institutions receiving this exhibit?
So the question was, how does the impact of what we did with the Zuckerman go forward with the show? So the next stop is at the Bronx Museum, and then there's also a venue in Chicago. And we worked really closely with the Bronx to talk about how we were going to address these issues within the exhibition at the Zuckerman, and they were a strong partner and ally in some of those decision making. So I'm happy to say that some of the work that we did at the Zuckerman will be traveling with the show now. So we were able to have an imprint on the show in a way that will be traveling. So some of the artists that were included in the exhibition that we selected will be traveling to the Bronx. We did an interview dialogue between Gila Beja and Sir Rodney Sir, talking about some of these issues around the show that will be traveling with the show. So that's great that happened. And what I think it also did was it activated the Bronx Museum, who absolutely, I think that absolutely do, as an institution, think about some of these issues with some of, with the shows that they produce and are doing additional programming and additional additions into the show on their own level. So I think, you know, it's a little bit of responsiveness and then and reaction, but also, you know, this is charged, the Zuckerman and the Bronx to be active participants in the show as well.
Thanks for your patience, Alex. You wanted to continue?
This is probably obvious, but I just wanted to ask, if a museum's exhibition or programming is in any way, shape, or form representing the community that it's in, it's just not doing the work. It's not really representative. I don't understand why sometimes it's like what Anthony was saying, people are asking this question about why. And I don't really understand why this magnitude just didn't think it was odd that you didn't have people of color in this exhibition. And I don't really, do you need it in preservation to tell you, hey, there's more than one group suffering from this issue? I don't know, I'm the first with my friends. I need anybody to advise me on certain issues of that magnitude to say, you know, you need to tap into it, to tell you, you should look at the full spectrum. And I think that applies to anything. I don't think it's any sort of program. If you're not a reflection of the community, you're not doing work. That's okay, just give up.
Are there any other questions or comments? Thank you all for coming.